The Royal British Legion, 90 Years of Heroes, written by Matt Croucher, GC, read by Sean Barrett, Bernard Cribbins, Philip Franks, Keeley Hawes, and Nicky Henson.
Chapter 1. 1921 to 1930. Foundation and Early Steps. The Great War had inflicted death and suffering on a grand scale on those who participated in it. The unparalleled level of mobilization led to matching numbers of casualties, and the government of the day was overwhelmed by the task of trying to provide for those who had been afflicted. There was a clear need for an organization to represent the voices of those left widowed or disabled by the war to end all wars. Even before the end of the Great War, efforts were underway to provide a voice for those who had served in the British Armed Forces. In fact, three completely separate organisations had formed by the end of 1917. The National Association of Discharged Sailors and Soldiers, founded in Blackburn in 1916 and loosely affiliated with the trades union movement and the Labour Party. The National Federation of Discharged and Demobilised Sailors and Soldiers, based in London and with links to the Liberal Party. And the Comrades of the Great War, a non-political organisation that nonetheless had extensive links with the establishment of the day. These three organisations were joined by the left-wing National Union of Ex-Servicemen following the end of the Great War in November 1918. A number of efforts were made to unite these disparate groups, but it was not until the foundation of the United Services Fund, containing some £7 million in canteen profits from the war, that they managed to combine in order to ensure the fair distribution of the fund throughout the country. At the same time, Field Marshal the Earl Haig, the commander of the British Expeditionary Force during the First World War, had been leading a fundraising campaign for a united organisation providing assistance to ex-officers, the Officers' Association, and it became clear that a single body representing all these interests would best serve the needs of those whom they sought to help. In 1920, a conference brought about the amalgamation of all these bodies, ratified by their individual members. On the 14th of May, 1921, the new unified organisation was founded under the name the British Legion, with the Prince of Wales as its patron and Earl Haig as its first president. The Legion had much to do. The first poppy appeal was launched the same year, widely supported by Earl Haig, and timed to coincide with Armistice Day, the 11th of November, 1921. This proved to be an enormous success, and provided the funds for the Legion to support those affected by the Great War, either directly, in terms of financial aid, employment or housing, or by raising political awareness of their plight through constant campaigning. The Legion was also central to the commemoration of the conflict, being deeply involved in the establishment of the 11th of November as Remembrance Day, and the later adoption of Remembrance Sunday, while 1927 saw the first Legion-organised Festival of Remembrance. With the passing of Earl Haig in 1928, the Legion played a central role in his funeral. This was a moment of national mourning, as Haig's reputation was as yet untouched by criticism of his wartime tactics and planning, and the Legion's central role underlined how quickly it had become a central part of British national life.
Sepoy Isha Singh, VC, awarded the 25th of November 1921, Waziristan, 28th Punjabis. Isha Singh was the first Sikh to win the Victoria Cross for his bravery when the convoy he was protecting was attacked by tribesmen in Waziristan in April 1921. Waziristan had been the scene of a revolt against British rule from 1919 to 1920. While British and Indian forces had been preoccupied by the First World War, the Waziris had launched a series of raids against British positions and supply columns, and this intensified in the wake of the Third Anglo-Afghan War of 1919 into a large-scale revolt. Although this rebellion had been largely put down by the end of 1920, there were still a number of raids throughout 1921, and it was in one of these that Isha Singh won his VC. Entering the Indian Army in 1913, Ishar Singh had served throughout the First World War in Ceylon, Mesopotamia, Palestine and Egypt before his regiment was posted to Waziristan in 1919 to help put down the revolt. On the 10th of April 1921, he was part of the escort for a camel convoy when rebellious tribesmen ambushed the column in a narrow gorge. Ishar Singh was the number one of a Lewis gun section, and in the immediate aftermath of the attack he was seriously wounded in the chest and lost hold of his Lewis gun. The initial assault had killed all the officers of his company, and, realizing the seriousness of the situation, he immediately counterattacked along with two colleagues and succeeded in wresting back his weapon, which he then manned until reinforcements arrived. Despite being ordered to report for medical attention, Ishar Singh helped the medical officer for the next 3 hours, bringing water for the wounded and protecting the injured and the officer from enemy fire, until he became too weak from loss of blood and finally received medical attention. Following the award of his medal, Ishar Singh travelled to London in 1929 to attend a dinner for VC recipients. He was later one of Edward VIII's Indian orderly officers in 1936. He died on the 2nd of December, 1936.
David Lloyd George, 1st Earl Lloyd George of Dwyfor, OM. David Lloyd George was a social reformer and British Prime Minister who led Britain to victory over Germany and her allies. Despite ruling over a coalition government and having very difficult relations with military leaders. In December 1916, while Britain was in the throes of the First World War, Prime Minister Herbert Asquith was forced out of office and his place was taken by David Lloyd George, the son of a Welsh schoolmaster. The war was not going well, and Lloyd George had a seemingly impossible job ahead of him. One of the first things that he did was to create a small, 5-man war cabinet responsible for making the essential decisions about the running of the war. This new cabinet was intended to end the previous cabinet's drawn-out discussions that had often resulted in indecision, hampering the war effort. The war cabinet was considered to be a great success. It met every day during the war and was responsible for all major military, diplomatic, and economic decisions. An imperial war cabinet was also created, which included representatives from around the empire. Lloyd George was not on the best of terms with military leaders, and he constantly tried to reduce their power. However, the endless clashes between government and military simply resulted in more difficulties when trying to plan a successful wartime strategy. One of his most tragic failures was his inability to stop the Passchendaele offensive in the summer of 1917. Despite arguing against it, he was outvoted, and it went ahead, resulting in the loss of as many as 250,000 British soldiers by its end in November of that year. However, he did succeed in creating the Supreme War Council at Versailles, which was used to coordinate Allied military strategy. His main aim had been to reduce the authority of William Robertson, the chief of the Imperial General Staff, and Douglas Haig, the commander-in-chief of the army. In this, he was to some extent successful, as Robertson resigned. Lloyd George did have one resounding military success during the course of the war. As the loss of shipping to U-boat attacks grew, he insisted on the adoption of a convoy system by the Navy. By the end of 1917, the system had been implemented and was considered a success, with losses being significantly reduced. Lloyd George went on to lead Britain to eventual victory in November 1918 and was hailed as a great wartime leader. After the war, he was re-elected and played a significant role in the negotiation of the Treaty of Versailles. At home, he continued with his attempts at social reform. However, he was part of a coalition government, and many members did not back his plan. By 1922, he had lost a lot of support and found himself embroiled in a major scandal over the sale of honours. He resigned as Prime Minister in October 1922, although he remained active in politics into the 1940s. He died of cancer on the 26th of March, 1945.
Lieutenant Arthur Wesley Ween, MM and 2 bars, awarded 21st of September, 1916, Western Front, AIF. Arthur Wesley Ween, a renowned academic most famous for the coining of the phrase "all quiet on the Western Front," was an unlikely hero whose bravery during the Great War earned him the Military Medal with 2 bars. Arthur Wien's graduation from Oxford University in 1923 was the start of his career as a librarian and translator. However, by the time he graduated from Oxford, he had not only fought on the Western Front, but also in Egypt, showing bravery and dedication when confronted with the horrors of the battlefields of the Great War. Australian by birth, Arthur Wien joined the Australian Imperial Force, AIF, in 1915, and spent the first few months of 1916 as a signaller in Tel El Kebir in Egypt. In June 1916, he was posted to France, and it was in France that he showed the strength of character for which he would be remembered in later life. At Petion, in July 1916, while under heavy artillery fire, he repaired telephone wires that had been cut and managed to maintain communications at great personal risk and self-sacrifice, a feat for which he was awarded the Military Medal in September 1916. He went on to be awarded the first bar for action at Bulancourt in March 1917, and the second bar for action at Villers-Bretonneux in April 1918. He was wounded twice in action, the first time in September 1917 and again in September 1918, and was eventually sent home as an invalid, arriving in Sydney in March 1919. Having been chosen as a Rhodes Scholar, Wien read modern history at New College, Oxford, graduating with third-class honours owing to health problems. After graduation, he accepted the job of assistant librarian at the Victoria and Albert Museum in London. It was here that he was instrumental in shaping the library which is now known as the National Art Library. Wien was a brilliant linguist and is most famous for his work as a translator. In 1929, he translated Erich Maria Remarque's Im Westen nichts Neues, the title of which he translated as All Quiet on the Western Front, a phrase that is still used in common parlance to this day. He translated a number of other works, including two more novels by Remarque, and also wrote one short story called Two Maters. He went on to become Keeper of the Library in 1945, a post he held until his retirement in 1962. Arthur Wien passed away on the 15th of March 1971 in Amersham Hospital. This brave soldier and noble scholar is best summed up by his obituary in The Times, where he is described as a man of great sweetness of nature, kindness, and generosity of heart.
Captain Frederick John Walker, CB, DSO, and 3 bars. Awarded the Distinguished Service Order 6th of January 1942, Battle of the Atlantic, Royal Navy. Captain Johnny Walker was the most successful anti-submarine warfare commander of the Second World War, sinking more U-boats during the Battle of the Atlantic than any other Allied commander. Frederick Walker's journey to achieving this accolade might have been said to have started in 1924 with the establishment of the anti-submarine training school at Portland, HMS Osprey. Walker took a training course there in 1926 and went on to become a specialist in the field, using his expertise in a number of postings during the interwar years. However, by the start of the Second World War, it seemed as though Walker's career was over. Having been passed over for promotion to captain, he had been due to take early retirement, a plan put on hold by the commencement of the war. In 1940, he became Staff Officer, Operations, to Vice Admiral Sir Bertram Ramsay, and although this was an important anti-submarine role, Walker still wanted to have command of his own ship so that he could try out the tactics that he had formulated. This ambition was fulfilled in October 1941, when he was given command of the 36th Escort Group and HMS Stork. He was now able to put into practice his belief that a combined attack from both air and sea would effectively combat the U-boat threat while keeping the convoy protected. His first contact with U-boats happened when his group was escorting home the 32 ships of the HG-76 convoy from Gibraltar in December 1941. 5 U-boats were sunk during the journey, and Walker was awarded the Distinguished Service Order for daring, skill, and determination while escorting to this country a valuable convoy in the face of relentless attacks from the enemy. Walker's group destroyed at least 3 more U-boats before he became Captain D, Liverpool, in September 1942. He was awarded a bar to his Distinguished Service Order in July 1942. His next command was 2 Support Group, an HMS Starling, which he took charge of in February 1943. He continued to successfully combat the U-boats using his innovative techniques, and in September 1943, he was appointed a Companion of the Bath for leadership and daring in command of HMS Starling in successful actions against enemy submarines in the Atlantic. He was awarded a second bar to his DSO in February 1944.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.